I bring greetings from Euphoria, the youth ministry of Aldersgate Methodist Church, all the youths there. Thank you to pastors for giving me the opportunity, for giving us, the youth ministry, opportunity to serve you and serve God in the house today. I don't know how many of you remember last year what I preached about last year's Youth Sunday. Do you all remember? I see some blank face, some mumbling and murmuring. Last year, I spoke about, from Paul to Timothy, you know, about the generation before us and the generation after us. How are we walking with different generations, either as a mentor to someone or as a mentee to a mentor? I don't know how many of you actually took that and began looking for someone to walk with in a congregation. But I hope that in the preaching of the Word of God, in the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God, that the Word of God would transform our lives. That as the Word of God, as you hear the Word of God, it will transform your life. You know, the Word of God should challenge our minds, convict our hearts, transform our lives. So even as we dive into the Word of God, let us pray. Lord Jesus, you are the one that we seek for. Lord, today I ask that you open scriptures and teach us, Lord, may the meditations of our heart be pleasing unto you. Even as we hear your word, Lord, would our hearts be one with you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So this year, as I was trying to sense what I feel, you know, the word is for us, I sense the word calling. I sense the word calling. And everyone wants to be in the middle of their destiny and their calling. You know, you hear statements like, rise up, take hold of the calling that God has put upon your life. But how many of us actually feel that emboldened to take up the elusive calling? How many of us, when we hear such a word, when we hear the word calling, have a firm grasp on that calling that God has for us? At the end of the day, the word calling could just be a word wrapped up with so many other meanings for a simple core need, the need to know how we play a part in the greater picture, how we play a part in the greater vision of God's kingdom, in the greater scheme of things. We just want to know how we add value, how we can play a part. And that could be one of the things you're thinking about when I mention the word calling. Is today's word, this word of calling, for the young people? Yes, it is. It's definitely for them. They are at the crossroads of their lives, some of them thinking about what course to take in university, what route to take. For some of the young adults, it's their career path. Some, you know, they're just figuring out, what should I study so that I can be in line with this elusive calling that God has put on my heart. But make no mistake, this word is also for every single one of us. Every single one of us in different seasons of our lives, the word calling, this word and what Jesus has to say about our calling is still very relevant to every one of us. So today, you know, I hope you would open your Bibles to Luke 5, 1 to 11. And I'm going to read for us in the scripture. On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake. But the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep, let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered, Master, we toiled all night and took nothing. But at your word, I will let down the nets. And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. And they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. for he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. This is the word of God. You know, in this story about Jesus, Luke's account of Jesus, we see a very interesting scene, which I'm going to dive into later. But first, I want to touch on something that is dear to my heart, and it is the point of our faith. On the accounts of four gospel writers and one missionary, began the explosive growth of the early Christian communities. And who was the accounts based on? It is one man, Jesus Christ. I don't know how many of you hear the claims that we make. The outrageous claims that Christians make today is that we hear God and we know the words of God and we have a direct line of communication to God. Do you know how crazy that sounds to other people? That today, if you were to come and pray in the house of God, that God will hear your prayers. And that you can have an intimate relationship with an all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-present God through Jesus Christ. Because of this, how many of us know God? How many of us know God? Or how many of us think we know God? Maybe let's not talk about God, let's talk about Jesus Christ, the one that we always sing about and talk about in our faith. How many of us actually know the words of Jesus? Do we know what he teach? Do we know what he says? Do we know what he values? Do we know what he wants us against? Do we know the gravity of what he said of himself, and how much problems Jesus caused the religious institutions of the day? On Jesus rests the foundation of our churches. And back in the time, the religious leaders' concept of forgiveness of sin was through the sacrifice of the lamb. Jesus came to say, "Your sins are forgiven." When the Jewish leaders' concept of meeting God was in the temple, Jesus says in John, "If you have seen me, you have seen the Father." If Jesus isn't a foundation, we Christians have very weak grounds to base our religious practices on. And I'll say that again. If Jesus isn't our foundation, we Christians have very weak grounds to base our religious practices on. We will have nothing to reorientate us to, nothing to realign us to, and nothing to review about our lives if Jesus is not our foundation. If Jesus isn't our foundation, we have nothing to base our call upon. So I'm going to dive straight into the text today. And when we read the Gospels, we need to understand the message of each Gospel writer. And the Gospel of Luke highlights many instances where Jesus taught and did these miraculous things, and Luke highlights for us the responses of the people, how they responded to Jesus as he walked on earth as a man, as our King and Lord walked on earth. Different people have different responses, and you will soon find out some weren't favorable, but some were. And so today, this text is a response, it's a teaching of response. Luke highlights for us the kind of response that we need to have when we encounter Jesus. And this account is particularly interesting because it's an in-depth account of one special person, one particular character, and it's Simon Peter. Simon Peter. And Luke records for us this so that he lays out a progression of responses that if we are to apprehend the call that God has upon our life, if we want to take hold of the call that God has upon our lives, we must re-examine our hearts and submit ourselves to these heart checks of responses. And the first response is obedience. It's obedience. I don't know how many of you would dive into the text and not just read it as a story, but Simon Peter is a fisherman. He's a seasoned fisherman. He is someone who has done this business for quite a while, and he knew that if you were to fish in the day, maybe you wouldn't get so much fish. But if you fish at night, fishes are largely nocturnal, so you might get a bigger catch at night. And so, in the story, we see the crowds pressing in on Jesus. How many of you have ever been pressed in on by a crowd? Like, have you all, I don't know, some of you maybe gone to a concert or the bazaar, Ramadan bazaar. I don't know whether you all feel a sense of a crowd pressing in on you before. I want you to immerse yourself in the narrative that Luke writes and records for us. The crowds were pressing in on Jesus. It's uncomfortable. It's frenzy. It's like he has no space to breathe. It's pressing in on Jesus. Why? To hear what Jesus has to say, because Jesus is rather famous. He has done many things, said many things at this point, and the crowds want to hear what else Jesus has to say. And Jesus, being really smart, he looks and he sees two boats at his side. And he says, he gets into one of the boat, and in one of them was Simon. He says, put out a little from the land. So then the boat, you know, kind of just sits just a little from the shore where he can still teach, but he's away from the crowds pressing in on Jesus. And Jesus begins to teach. He begins to teach in other gospels. It records for us what is the content that he teaches, but he teaches. Hey, but I want to draw your attention to what happens next. So if you're following me in your Bibles, whether electronically or physically, please, I want you to follow with me because it's a text and Jesus that disciples us, not my words. And so what happens next is that he looks on to Simon Peter and he tells Simon Peter, put down your nets for a catch. Now you must know that these are seasoned fishermen. Simon Peter knows what he's doing. In fact, he is washing his nets before Jesus even got into the boat. He's done with his work. It's like, there's nothing else left for me to do. I'm just going to close shop. I'm going to go home. I need a rest. I've been toiling all night. And Jesus, not only does he get into Simon Peter's boat and prolongs his agony of staying awake, you know, he tells Simon Peter now to let down your nets for a catch. Means Simon Peter has to wash his nets another time, like again. And so, the response of Simon Peter is this. I'm going to read to you. Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets. And this is the first response of obedience. When Simon Peter did not understand what was going on, he obeyed. He obeyed. And what happened next defied all logic and it defied all common sense. We read that they enclosed a large number of fish and their nets were breaking, so much so that they had to signal to the other boat and call them to come and fill both boats filled with fishes. I don't know how this scene will look or how it plays out in your mind, but if you were to immerse yourself in the story, you must know that it is frenzied. It's just crazy. You know, they call the other boat, and they filled two boats worth of fishes. It already defied the logic of the fishermen. How many of us have the same kind of obedience? How many of us have the same kind of obedience? Will you obey Jesus even when you lack full understanding in your circumstances? And that leads me to the second response. You know, if you were in that scene, if I were in that scene, there are two things I'll be thinking about. The first thing is I'll be starting to count the number of fishes that I'm going to catch that I have on my boat, in my nets, and the amount of fishes in the other boat. I am counting the catch for today because I know that if I were to drag my boat into the market, or drag my fish into the market, I'm going to bring in a killing. I'm going to get in like a week's worth of wages. I'm going to be rich for a while. The second thing will be, I'll be thinking, is Jesus looking for a job? Because he's doing pretty well as a fisherman. At his word, the fishes I catch. I want to employ Jesus as my co-fisherman. You see, but I want to draw your attention to the second response of Simon Peter. I'm going to read to you. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. What is this response? Our normal response would be to rejoice, right? Like, I mean, we have fish. We can go and sell. We got a lot of money, and we can enjoy ourselves. Maybe don't have to work for the next 1 week, or 2 weeks, or 1 month. But look at Simon Peter's response of repentance. I am a sinful man. What did he see in Jesus and in himself that made him respond that way? What did he see in Jesus and what did he recognize in himself that made him respond that way? Do we have a fear of God in our hearts over our condition? And I don't mean coming every week just to recite a prayer, you know, that we acknowledge that we have sinned against each other, sinned against God. But do we have a sense of how selfish we actually are? How angry we can be, how bitter we can grow, and how lack of compassion we have. That we actually don't have that much compassion, we don't have that much love for the people around us. Sometimes we can be self-righteous. Do we recognize how hopelessly weak we are without Jesus? We need to feel immensely broken and grieved over our sin and condition. Only then can we begin to understand how beautiful, how wonderful the sacrifice of Jesus is and how good he is. When we are immensely broken and grieved over our condition, our sinful condition, then we begin to understand why Jesus' sacrifice makes so much sense and why he is beautiful. He is the God, there is none other like him. And we come to worship him, the foundation of our faith. So will you recognize your need and sin before Jesus and fall down at his knees? The final response that I want to bring your attention to in this narrative is the radical following of the disciples. And is this final response the one that will address the calling issue of our lives? You see, when they have brought the boat to shore and they have left everything to follow him, it is recorded for us that they left everything to follow Jesus. We think that they left their livelihoods behind, and which they did. They left the jobs as fishermen to follow Jesus for the rest of their lives, not knowing what is the next step, not knowing how they're going to get the food or where they're going to stay. But I want to suggest to you one other thing that they left behind, and that is two boats full of fishes on the shore. When they docked, you must imagine that if you were there, you are counting the number of fish and the number of amount of money you can bring in. That when Luke records for us that these fishermen did not just leave the job, they left the immediate gratification right there. They left the two boats full of fishes and they followed Jesus. How many of us have things that we are holding on to that are hindering us from following Jesus? And I'm not asking you to lay down your jobs and or work in church. No, I'm not. But I have a sense that Jesus could be putting his finger on one or two things in our lives that we are holding on to. That unless we leave them at the shore, we will be unable to follow Jesus. And so Jesus never calls us to a job. He never calls us to a vocation and let that become our identity. My suggestion is that, you know, we always say, my calling is to be a pastor, my calling is to missionary, my calling is to be a doctor, my calling is to be a teacher. I want to suggest to you that instead of saying that, you could say that my calling is to follow Jesus. He leads me to a vocation of being a teacher. My calling is to follow Jesus. He leads me to a vocation of being a doctor. He leads me into a vocation of full-time ministry or being a pastor or being a missionary. But your call is to follow Jesus. The trouble with the first kind of statement is that we tend to romanticize calling. And what if you lose your limbs? What if you are impaired? What if you do not have the same amount of opportunities as the rest of us do? Do you not have a calling to take hold of? I think they do. I think you do. But it will look drastically different from what we have in our minds, the romantic idea of this calling and vocation that we are to achieve. Instead, I would like us to turn our eyes onto Jesus and say, my calling is to follow Jesus Christ. And when he leads me to a particular vocation, I will obey and I will go. In this story, immediately Jesus gives the fishermen a new vocation, and it is to be catching men. But that's not their ultimate calling, because the last sentence of this narrative, the calling is to follow him. The point is, get your responses, get our responses right towards Jesus, and the vocation that Jesus leads you will be a natural progression. And to sum up this narrative, I can sum it up succinctly with two words, and it's to follow him. Submit your lives to God, submit, you know, your questioning and your heart to Jesus, and ask yourself, are you obedient? Are you obeying what Jesus is telling you? Are you repentant? Have you the right view of you in front of God? Do you have the right view of yourself and the right view of God? And then finally, to follow him. And to conclude, I hope that you can ask yourself, where do you find yourself in the narrative? Where do you see yourself? And how do you respond in your heart? Are you like one of the crowd, pressing in only to hear the words of Jesus, but not willing to follow him? I challenge you, church, to not be like the crowds, only wanting to hear Jesus, but unwilling to follow. I challenge you to ask yourself, where are you in the discipleship process with Jesus? Are you one in the crowd? Are you pre-miracle Simon Peter? Or are you post-miracle Simon Peter? Are you obeying God's prompting in your life to read his word, to pray, to minister and serve each other, to love each other? Are you repentant on a daily basis over your condition? And then finally, is there something that you need to leave behind at the shores to follow him? I pray that we all come into encounters with God that provokes us into examining our lives and our responses to him. And Jesus invites us all on the same discipleship journey. And I encourage you to make the step and to follow him, because that is the greater call of our lives. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the words. I thank you for the gospel writers who narrate for us the accounts of what you said and what you did. Lord, may we fall more in love with you. May we fall more in love with you. May we understand that our calling is to follow you, Lord Jesus, and that you will lead us into any areas of our lives, of work, of vocation, of passion. But Lord, may we never forget the call first to you, to read your word, to pray, to love you, to grow closer in intimacy and relationship with you. That from that place, Lord, we will serve the household of God, and from that place, Lord, we will serve your people, we will serve each other, we will serve the world. So I thank you, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, I pray that you be our counselor and our teacher and our guide. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.